special.
Dad, I have never done anything right. I've been going around with my head in a sling for years.
You never really loved us. I know why you didn't love me. Because I'm like my mother, and you never forgave yourself for having loved her.
If I had one day when I didn't have to be all confused and I didn't have to feel that I was ashamed of everything, if I felt that I belonged someplace, you know?
Mom, I want to do something right. And I don't want you to run away from me again. Get out! You're tearing me apart!
It may be hard to believe, but it's been nearly 20 years since James Dean was killed. Yet people who weren't even born when Dean made Eden, Rebel, and Giant feel something special when he slouches onto the screen, his chin tucked down shyly, his eyes full of hurt, sensitivity, and pride. He says something to this generation, just as he said something to their parents 2 decades ago. It's quite an achievement for an actor who starred in only 3 movies. But in those films, and in his life, he became a symbol of youthful rebellion, which expressed itself in a disturbing combination of tenderness and violence.
You've been awfully nice, Cal, taking care of me.
Rebel. He really was the first young guy who played a young guy in a film who rebelled against the establishment and gave the teenager an identity.
But I would say that all of us were touched by Jimmy and that he was touched by greatness.
As an American phenomenon, he was, sadly, typical of many American young people.
James Dean clanged, sometimes in the wrong key, on the screen and off screen. But at least he clanged, which is more than most people do.
He was a nice, normal cat who did his number and did it better than anybody else in the world.
I give to you Jet Rink.
This was to be James Dean's final scene, for within a few short weeks after completing Giant, he would die in a car crash. But the adulation was only just beginning for this unique star who would exit without a word. James Dean was in his early 20s when he appeared in Giant. He was already a major star with apparently a brilliant future ahead of him. He was also a problem to his studio because of his love for reckless driving, to his friends because of his chameleon personality. Though none of the recent studies of Dean has uncovered it, one person who broke through Dean's protective shell a bit in his last days, who came close to him in a special way, was Sammy Davis Jr. Sam, how come none of these studies get into your friendship with James?
I don't know, Peter. I think perhaps because it was a very kind of a personal thing. When I say personal, I mean we didn't go to a lot of parties together. What Jimmy would do, he would come up to the house because we lived comparatively close together. And I was living with my grandmother at the time, Rosa B., who you knew, mm-hmm. and she never knew he was in the movies. You know, she just thought he was one of the buddies, one of the gang, one of the friends. And he would come up in the middle of the afternoon and, you know, pick up the pot, look in it, you know, what you cooking tonight? She'd get your hand off my pot, you know, as Rosa B. was prone to do. And we became friends on that level. And he would show up, you know, uninvited. And in those days, as you were well aware of, every night was party night for me. And I was kind of busy trying to do my own thing, meaning that it was just starting to happen for me. So I think that because of that, and because there were so many people around, nobody even attached our friendship, but it was a good friendship, because it was an honest friendship. Yeah. It was an honest relationship.
It wasn't a movie magazine.
Right. No way.
Opening night friendship.
No, yeah. None of that.
You knew him, of course, when you were with him in the days before his death.
Yes.
What kind of a person was he, really?
Well, I can probably best explain it to you by saying that I talked Jimmy into coming to a party that Ella Logan was giving for me in the Valley. Mm. And we had closed Ciro's, and she wanted to give me a party. And she said, gee, I've invited all your friends and all your buddies, and you know what, I've invited Marlon Brando. Do you know him? I said, yes, I know him from New York. She says, it would be marvelous if Brando could come to the party and relax and have a good time, which we want him to have, because they understand he's kind of moody. So I'm telling Jimmy about this that night, and he says, Marlon's going to be at the party, huh? I said, yeah. He said, can I come? And I said, of course you can, huh? I said, it wouldn't be a party if you wouldn't be there, sitting in the corner someplace, right? And he said, all right, I'll be there. And he wore Marlon's complete, you know, the wild one,
yeah.
Wore the whole outfit, came in on the motorcycle, walked in with the leather jacket, the boots, everything, and Marlon arrived in a suit and a tie.
Oh, that's lovely.
And Jimmy went, he tricked me, man. He really tricked me. And it was so funny because the whole night, that night, they hung out and talked, and I remember asking about a year later, have you seen him? Have you seen Marlon recently? He says, no, man. He's on the lot, but he won't even speak to me. You know? Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's true or not, but he had that one evening.
Yeah, that's funny. What was you knew of him? What would James Dean think of the adulation, the cults, the legends that have sprung up about him?
I think he would think it's a giggle. I think he would be proud of it, but I think he wouldn't take it. I think he would kind of give it that half smile of his. I mean, no kidding, man. They really do and all that. Huh? You know, that's my impression of what he would do.
I agree, you're probably
you know,
right.
That he would just do that and go, yeah. Really? Because that's the kind of cat he was to me, you know. Now, that's the side I saw of him. Because it's very funny, if you get four or five people around who knew Jim, everyone has a story to tell that they remember. Well, everyone has something to say about it, but if you put them all together, it almost sounds as if you're talking about four or five different people.
Mm-hmm.
Say, for a point here and a point there, you know, that's all.
A show business writer, Maurice Zolotow, has written, and I'll read it to you. I don't know whether you read it or not. And he says, to some extent, what our country will become tomorrow is determined by whom our children admire today. Why should we shed maudlin tears and slobber over the memory of James Dean? What's so brave and beautiful about stepping on the gas, blowing your horn, and speeding down a public highway like a maniac? How do you feel about that?
Well, I think that's it's an ill-advised statement for openers. I just think that there's a lot of jealousy about Jimmy, you know. A lot of jealousy in terms of why should he have all this adoration? Why should people, you know, years after he's passed, why should people still have a kind of a thing about him? Well, there are only two people in the world that I can remember within my lifetime that created that. One was Marilyn Monroe, and the other was James Dean. And, you know,
In our business.
In our business, I mean. And it's a, I think it's a tremendous compliment. I do not agree with the statement. I think that he had something to say to the youth of America. They believed him because he dealt honestly with it. And he portrayed them on that. They felt him up there on that screen.
And they can feel.
Oh, boy.
Can feel anything.
Tell me
about
it.
Cannot fool them.
Beside the love of the man and the love of the talent, I never told him, Peter, how good he was.
Mm.
I never took time out to say to him, man, you're magnificent. I said it to other people around him, but I never said it to him. And it hurts me to this day. And that's one of the reasons that, you know, we've been out a million times together. We see a show. You're like I am. Rush backstage and tell somebody because you may never see them again if you enjoyed their performance.
That's true.
You know, and it's like a friendship. If you like somebody, tell them, hey, I like you, man. You know, and it broke my heart that I never got a chance to tell him that. But I think he knew because he showed it in a lot of ways, not in with gifts and all that jazz, but with the gift of friendship.
Yeah. James Dean was obviously an extremely complex personality, a riddle even to those who knew him best. On rare occasions, however, he let the curtain part and permit a glimpse into his past. And it was Dean's past that put an indelible stamp on what he was to become. James Byron Dean was born in 1931 to a sensitive mother who surrounded him with warmth, encouraging him to play the violin and tap dance in amateur theatricals. These were his only serene years, for at 9, his mother suddenly died, and to a child's mind, she had deserted him. Sent by his father to the Indiana farm of an aunt and uncle, he felt this too a form of parental rejection. Something would be emotionally missing for the rest of his life. He seemed to like the farm and its simple ways, which haven't changed much to this day. And his uncle and aunt, hard-working Quakers, gave him all the comfort and affection they could. But they could never enter the hidden places of childhood where he nursed the pain of losing his parents. The nearest town was Fairmont, a quiet, Andy Hardy sort of place, where Dean went to school and, despite his secret hurts, became an apparently well-adjusted boy with a drive for recognition at sports, emerging, though comparatively short, as a high school basketball star. He also distinguished himself by capturing first place in the state's dramatic speaking contest with a monologue called The Madman, which he began with a blood-curdling scream. High school dramatics, undoubtedly the influence of his artistic mother, began to intrigue him. And here, too, he gave everything his own distinctive, if bizarre, touch. At 18, James Dean left Fairmont, Indiana, for Hollywood, California, to live again briefly with his father, now a virtual stranger, and to become an actor. This was Dean's very first professional role as the Apostle John in a Father Peyton television drama. Jimmy had barely a handful of lines, but his brief appearance in this religious program inspired girls at one Catholic high school into forming the first James Dean fan club. His acting was stilted, yet something else must have come across.
I suggest we leave these precincts and go back to Galilee, where we belong.
Good suggestion, Andrew.
Well spoken, Andrew.
Now that's wisdom.
Surely we did not spend 3 years following the Master to return again to our nets. Was it for this the Master sent us out to cure the sick, cast out devils?
Andrew, rejoice. He has risen as he promised.
Fan club or not, after this dramatic debut, James Dean's career didn't seem to stand a prayer.
Go on! You just like all the rest of them, you're all against me! All of you! All of you!
An astonishingly new James Dean, without robes or sainthood, began to emerge on television in the early 1950s. Raised on an Indiana farm, Dean was the antithesis of a big city delinquent. But he had a raw sensitivity for roles filled with anger and rage.
Oh, yeah. Johnny, boy, I'm coming down, boy.
Joe, I said put that gun down.
Come and get me.
We can't take any more chances. Let him have it.
That was one of James Dean's first and rather typical television roles in New York. He went there in 1951 because that's where the action was for young talent in those early days. He was fiercely ambitious, an ambition that began, as one version has it, when as a boy he wept angrily over his mother's grave and vowed that because she left him, he would show her he would be great without her. As a struggling actor, James Dean did some starving, but not for long. He was soon appearing in numerous early TV dramas, like this one with Georgianne Johnson, in which he played a psychotic convict. At the same time, on the Broadway stage, he won a Tony as the most promising young performer of the year. In acting circles, he was already being recognized as a natural, projecting remarkable emotional intensity.
You're hurting me.
First time I've touched a woman in 5 years. Ask me what my name is.
Please.
My name is Hank Braden. Before I was a convict, I was an intern, a good intern with a bad temper. My only weakness was... Never mind. Now you say to me, hello, Hank Braden.
You're hurting me.
Go on, fire!
Make believe I'm carrying your books home from school and you're hysterical with joy because my name is right, my money is right. I belong to a good fraternity. And my car is a long yellow convertible.
Dean's early success and distinctive personal chemistry brought him back to Hollywood within 3 short years. This time as a star. Not an easy transition to make for an insecure 23-year-old. But somehow that insecurity and all the other emotions that drove Dean personally were poured with stunning impact in films like Rebel Without a Cause, which also transformed a child actress into a major new star, Natalie Wood. Natalie, all kinds of studies are coming out now about James Dean and his significance as a social rebel. You starred in that picture. So many years later, what do you think that Dean's screen image conveyed?
Well, I think the main thing that it conveyed was his need, you know, was his kind of emotional need. And I think that really he was not a rebel in the sense that he was not rejecting parents. He wasn't sort of saying... leave me alone, I don't want to have anything to do with you, I'm going to do my own thing. He was really saying, listen to me, you know, hear me, love me.
He wasn't blaming anyone, but
he was just trying to get that connection. You know, so much in Rebel, the scene where he was saying to his father, you know, he was trying to make the parents into people that, you know, he could love and into people that would help him, that would give him. It seems to me that kids today are sort of saying, it's a wrap. I'm turning on and I'm dropping out.
Yeah.
And Jimmy was really trying to fight his way through still, I think, you know.
Yeah.
In a very active way, you know, he was saying,
looking for communication.
Stand up to his dad, you know, and communication. Yeah, exactly that.
Is it possible, however, that Dean blazed the trail for the Mick Jaggers, the Bob Dylans, David Bowies, even the Alice Coopers? Without one, wouldn't we have had the others?
Well, maybe not. I mean, maybe one is the, you know, it's the other side of the moon. But I think that it's interesting that at that time he had such an impact, even before his death, you know, and then certainly with his death. And now still again, all these years later. So there must be something universal in what Jimmy transmitted, you know.
He planted a big seed.
Oh, yeah.
Now, what about Dean himself in those days? What can you remember about him that made him so intriguing?
Well, again, the thing about Jimmy that strikes me now in looking back, I mean, at the time he seemed like a great nonconformist and a great rebel and an eccentric and all of that. But really, he was eccentric only, by today's standards, he wouldn't be eccentric at all, I don't think. I mean, he wouldn't wear ties, he wouldn't wear suits, he wouldn't go to social functions, he wouldn't do the Hollywood thing, you know, he wouldn't do what the studios expected him to do. But yet today, many actors don't do any of those things.
Right.
You know, most young people don't wear, you know, don't get dressed up and do all of that.
Most old people, too.
Exactly. I mean, nobody does. But I think, you know, he was not into drugs or anything very spooky or weird. I think he was a very healthy young
spiritual
man.
Spiritual, I
was. Yes, very moody and poetic, but not freaked out or drugged out or anything like that.
Natalie, at the time, was he aware of the fact that he was becoming a cultural symbol and a star?
No, not a cultural symbol. He certainly wasn't aware of that. I don't think he was at that time. But he was very aware of the fact that he was a star. There was no escaping it. I mean, eyes were on him. And I remember when we did a television show before we did Rebel, and we used to go to lunch on his motorcycle to a nearby hamburger joint. And he used to be fascinated with the stories that were being written about him in the movie magazines, you know. So a lot of them were about his love affair with Pierangeli, and he would read them. He wouldn't buy them, but he would be fascinated, you know, and then he'd sort of, you know.
Well, did you think they were trash and sort of?
Well, he wouldn't really say. You know, I think he was trying to figure out, you know, or keep a part of himself to himself, and then he was trying to figure out why did they see him in this other way, or how was he being seen by others, you know.
Before Rebel, you'd been a child star and very protected, I would imagine. How did you identify with that story?
Well, it was a very important film for me personally, because up until then I had worked as a child and I had always just done as I was told. I was, you know, you do this picture next and then you do that picture next, and I was a rather dutiful child. And when my parents read the script of Rebel, they said, oh, no, not this one, because this, you know, it showed parents in a rather unsympathetic light. And yet I read it, and for the first time in my life, I said, oh, wait a minute, I have to do this. I love this. You know, I love Judy, and I felt very much of a connection, identification with the part. And I guess I was going through my first rebellion.
One of the most powerful scenes in Rebel was a spectacular chicken run with Natalie, Dean, Sal Mineo, and Corey Allen, which served notice on the middle class that their alienated teenagers were a time bomb.
Hit your light!
Scene. Natalie, you said earlier that James Dean was not exactly a rebel. Now, why do people respond to him today? Why do people respond to him today, if you will? What does he mean today?
Well, of course, it's hard to say, but maybe it means that the young people want that connection again. I mean, maybe the dropping out, you know, dissociating is not working. Maybe he is personifying again, you know, a return to that connecting to one person. I mean, Jimmy was very romantic, really. I mean, he loved one person. He wanted to love one girl. It was a kind of a forever kind of love that he was searching for.
You had a romantic scene with him in Rebel, which in retrospect isn't shocking, but very touching. What is it about that scene that's so touching?
Well, I suppose the tentative quality of it. I know that we both felt very embarrassed. I was only a teenager, and I'd never played a love scene before. So for me, it was the first time I'd ever played a love scene, and I guess Jimmy had played, you know, one in East of Eden, but... he was quite embarrassed. In fact, some of the dialogue, he didn't quite, you know, didn't quite come out because he mumbled a bit.
I wasn't ready for it.
Hi.
Hi. Is this what it's like to love somebody?
I don't know.
What kind of a person do you think a girl wants?
A man?
Yes. But a man who can be gentle and sweet.
Yeah.
Like you are.
What's...
And someone who doesn't run away when you want them. Like being Plato's friend when nobody else liked him. That's being strong.
Oh, wow.
Well, I'm not going to be lonely anymore. Ever, ever. Not you or me.
I love somebody. All the time I've been looking for someone to love me. And now I love somebody. It's so easy. Why is it easy now?
I don't know. It is for me too.
I love you, Jim. I really mean it.
James Dean, as he's remembered today by Sal Mineo and Rock Hudson, with memorable scenes from his films.
Well, now you crud chicken,
don't
now you
call me that!
Violence slashed through James Dean's performance in Rebel Without a Cause. Not the social protest violence that ripped through America a decade later, but a prelude to it. The characters, alienated and bewildered, could not yet identify any clear-cut enemy. So they turn their violence against each other.
Look out, Buzz, he's got a chain!
Few people ever got close to James Dean, the person. One was his co-star and friend, Sal Mineo.
Sal, how does it feel to be standing on the same spot as that scene, but 20 years later?
Well, it all comes back in flashes, in very clear flashes, but I mainly feel that the place is still filled with ghosts. I don't mean just Jimmy's ghost, but anybody who has had anything to do with the film, Natalie, Nick Adams, and Corey, and everybody, because it was an experience that I've never experienced in a film before, that it was like a family, and everybody did become very tight. And it was almost like a spiritual experience. And it's all here now. And mainly that Jimmy was the focus of it. And we all grew around him, and as a result, I think we all did look up to him. And it's here, and it's a nice feeling, and it's not a morbid feeling.
What kind of relationship did you have during the film?
I was terrified of him. I was afraid of him. And I really didn't know him at all. And gradually it grew, as it did in the film. I began to idolize him. The thing that I loved about him, and the thing that I wanted to be one day, was the way he dealt with people on people in a higher position. He would never take anything from anybody. I mean, take any nonsense from anybody. And he would stand up to them, no matter what the situation was. And I said, far out, that's what I'd like to be able to do.
We read stories now about how cruel and unfeeling James Dean could be. Were you ever the target?
I never really thought of them as being unfeeling. I always thought that there was something behind some of his actions. I mean, things like there were mornings when he really was awful to people, in that he totally disregarded them, would never say anything, or to me personally. Not a good morning, nothing for a whole day. And all of a sudden, of course, I felt rejected. And I said, what did I do wrong? And that would happen with people in different areas and at different times. He was late a lot of times. It was difficult to get into a scene and, you know, those kinds of things. But eventually, of course, I was only 16 then, and I was very impressionable and very sensitive. If he didn't say good morning to me, I was a wreck that whole day. But when he did, and if he put his arm around me, that was fabulous, because then I knew he meant it. But I always felt he was testing people, testing to see how far he could push someone. And if someone stood up to him, he dug it. He respected that.
You and he have to play the dramatic climax of Rebel, which must have been a very dramatic scene to shoot, where despite his efforts to save you, you get killed. Can you remember that day?
Oh, yeah, it's very clear, and it was a very important day for me, in that the scene was that I ran out of the planetarium, got shot, and Jimmy then discovers me dead and hovers over me and expresses what he feels, the grief that he feels at that moment. So he had a number of choices to make. But what I had felt, strangely enough, was that here was a chance for me to feel what it would be like for someone close, someone that I idolized, to be grieving for me, and for me to experience what kind of grief that would be. What would he be like? What would he sound like? What would he be thinking? And I wanted to do that scene over and over again. And each time we did do it, he would position me in the kind of position that would work for him to get the emotion going. And it was very moving for me, because he was very moved, and when you see the scene, you'll see how he broke up in that moment. And it was seeing your idol there expressing his grief, and that was incredible. And immediately after the scene, I noticed that there was a change in the relationship. He was very protective, and that whole day, he would never let me out of his sight. He was always there, and that felt nice.
See? Come on.
Who's that?
Just a girl.
I shot up one of them.
No, it's all right. You didn't hurt him.
Those are not my friends.
Well, look.
Make them go away.
Are you warm? You want me to make them go away? Want me to fix it? Okay.
Jim!
Hey, Ray. You make those guys get back? You don't have to worry about anything. Here, Ray, keep the guys back. Ray?
That other kid still has a gun.
No!
Don't turn on the lights!
Don't. It's too bright. Glitter doesn't...
Turn out the lights!
Jim! Jim!
Come on!
Lieutenant.
Hey, Drek Pop. What'd you do that for?
Hey. Can't help it, son. You did everything a man could.
Actually have contact with him?
I went through a period, because it was something that we had discussed too during the relationship about making contact with people that are gone, with spirits and all of that. And I tried, and a number of years afterwards, when I finally did accept the fact that he died, I tried making contact with him through sometimes a Ouija board or with a glass and that kind of thing. And I believe it happened. I believe I did feel the presence. And I believe that there was a communication. Of course, I believe that it is possible to make communication with a spirit.
To Sal Mineo, James Dean was a friend, a hero, an ideal. To Natalie Wood, he was an intriguing free spirit, a character. But what's so fascinating about Dean is that he could be so many things to so many different people. Almost as if uncertain about who he was, he experimented with different identities. One of his closest friends for a time was Leonard Rosman, who composed the brilliant musical scores for Rebel and East of Eden. Len, you're a serious composer and intellectual. How did you strike up a friendship with someone as primitive as James Dean?
Well, firstly, I don't think he was that primitive, but we can talk about that later. I've met Jimmy in an odd way. A mutual friend of ours was a director and poet. I was working with him on a libretto to an opera for a Koussevitzky commission. And this mutual friend asked me to write music to a production which was done in New York, which happened to star Jimmy Dean. And Jimmy evidently liked the music. I had met Jimmy, but I didn't remember him after the performance. And some weeks later, he arrived at my doorstep and asked if I'd teach him piano. And I didn't remember who he was, but he looked like some strange Gestapo figure because he showed up in a kind of a motorcyclist outfit, which at that time was very outre in the middle of New York. And I was flabbergasted and delighted and began to teach him piano, formed a kind of friendship with him.
He never taken me piano before?
No. As a matter of fact, he had great difficulty because he had the... This joint on the fourth finger right hand was deformed, and he had a very difficult time even trying to play, but he wanted to play very badly.
Oh, extraordinary. Yeah. At the end, you were no longer friends. Why did it break up?
Well, several reasons. Without being too personal about it, I felt that the role that Jimmy expected me to play in his life, I simply couldn't play, which was that of a father. Mm-hmm. And it was exemplified by a fantastic exchange we once had. And there were many exchanges such as this, but he once tried to get me to come out and play basketball with him. And I said, well, Jimmy, you know, I don't like sports very much, at least those kinds of sports. And he just kept on pressuring, and I finally said, well, listen, why is it so important for you that I go out and play basketball with you? And he said, well, you know how a fellow feels. It's like you want your father to play ball with you. And I said, I blew up. I said, I'm not your father. Your father's alive and living in Burbank or wherever he was living at the time. I said, why don't you call your father and ask him to go and play basketball with you? I don't play basketball.
Sal Mineo looked up to Dean as an ideal, a hero. Millions of people responded in a similar way to what they saw on the screen. How did Dean feel about himself, do you think?
Well, you know, it's my contention that Many of the things that people adored about Jimmy were the wrong things, and not the things that one should have adored about Jimmy. By that, I simply mean that the things that he hated in himself and tried to escape from were the things that many of his fans adored. You see, this kind of seeming rebel and this kind of eccentric and so on, Jimmy had actually a kind of conservative fantasy about what he wanted to do. He wanted tranquility, he wanted to create in some way, he wanted to be a kind of an intellectual. I really don't know how deep that was, actually. Mm. But I think that he certainly was a bright young guy, would have been in his 40s now. You know, we were all young guys then.
Yeah.
And I think that this kind of runaway, the leather-jacketed man running from society, which was the figure of that time, you know, which was a kind of a middle-class version of the Wild Ones, which right. Brando had done several years back, was the kind of thing that Jimmy was compelled to do in some way, but at the same time, he really didn't... There was a side of him that didn't want to do it, and that's why, of course, he went into analysis toward the end of his life,
yeah.
because he really seeked to avoid that.
There's a serious new study of James Dean called The Mutant King
yes.
by David Dalton, and there's a one thing in here that he said. It's a quote from Dean in Mutant King. When asked if he were homosexual, he said, "Well, I'm certainly not going to go through life with one hand tied behind my back."
That's a funny idea. And you're asking me whether he was a homosexual?
Does that suggest that Dean at that time in his life was a homosexual or had experimented with it?
I have no personal evidence of that at all. He may have. I've heard that he had, but I must say that is absolute hearsay because in my entire experience with Jimmy, I didn't see any evidence of any homosexualism at all.
Mm.
Although he had told me at one time with regard to a certain situation that he had flirted with some homosexual people in order to get something that he wanted out of, I forget what it was exactly, some position or recognition or something like that. And it's the old story, you know, that if you flirt in a homosexual way with somebody in order to get something but really aren't a homosexual inside, it's the same as the fellow trying to get out of the army by spitting at the ceiling for 2 years. Is he not crazy?
Yeah.
You know? So I really don't know whether he really was a homosexual. He possibly tried it. He had thoughts. We all do, you know.
Mm.
And so that's my answer to it.
Yeah. His childhood, his feelings of being rejected undoubtedly had a traumatic influence. Did he ever talk to you about his parents?
Yes, he talked about his father. But he talked in a way that gave me the idea that he had absolutely no insight into the nature of his relationship with his father. Occasionally he would call his father. This was when we lived in New York, in that little apartment on 67th Street. He'd call his father, and of course I only heard one part of the conversation, but he was tremendously effusive and warm with his father. And it would seem almost as though what was going on the other side of the line was just as effusive and warm. But as I found out later on, and certainly after his death, that really wasn't the case. I guess his father was rather a repressed man.
It was a one-sided thing, then.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think Jimmy had a fantasy about his father. And if Jimmy didn't have a fantasy about his father, if this was the real relationship with his father, this warm, loving kind of thing, I don't think he'd want to go and play basketball with me.
No,
father,
exactly.
You know?
Yeah. And that just came out of some sort of rejection. You know?
Yeah, I think so.
You were on the set of East of Eden, which dealt with a boy's struggle for his father's love.
Yeah.
And there was that powerful scene where his father rejects him. Can you remember that day?
Oh, I remember it very well, quite vividly, because I remember Julie Harris. I came on the set late. They had either made a take or tried to make a take and didn't work, or else they were just about to. And Julie came over to me, and because Jimmy and I were inseparable at that time, and she said, "There's something terribly wrong with Jimmy. He's can't stop crying. He's terribly upset, you know." And I said, "Well, I don't know." So I went up to Jimmy's dressing room where Jimmy was there, and he was crying, carrying on terribly. And when Jimmy saw me coming, he waved me away. And I realized he was preparing. And,
yeah.
You know, and that was...
I was just going to say that.
Yes, so exactly.
His way of preparing.
Yes. And then, of course, when he did the scene, he couldn't stop crying afterwards. And he was just really carried away by the emotional content of the scene, what images he had formed in order to carry this this scene out in that way, I didn't know and I didn't ask him. Ray Massey was kind of an old school actor, but a marvelous man. And I saw the scene, and Ray was actually rather taken aback by Jimmy's non-make-believe attitude toward the scene, because he grabbed Ray and he forced Ray. And Ray was actually kind of pushing him away in the scene. Yeah. And it was a tremendously realistic scene, because it was real. It was real to Jimmy, I'm sure. Yeah.
What's this? What is this?
Well, I made it. And it's for you. It's all the money you lost on the lettuce.
You made it?
Yeah.
But how?
Beans.
Beans?
Yeah, we bought futures of 5 cents, and war came along, and the price went sky high. So, that's for you. And it's all the money you lost in the lettuce business. That's for you, and I made it for you.
Cal, you will have to give it back.
No, I made it for you, Dad. I want you to have it.
You'll have to give it back.
Who? I can't give it.
To the people you got it from.
No, British Purchasing Agency? I can't give it back to them.
Then give it to the farmers you robbed.
We didn't rob anybody. That we paid 2 cents a pound, 2 cents over market for that stuff.
Cal, I sign my name, and boys go out, and some die. And some live helpless without arms and legs. Not one will come back untorn. Do you think I could take a profit from that? I don't want the money, Cal. I couldn't take it. I thank you for the thought, but
I'll keep it for you. I'll wrap it up and we'll just keep it in here.
I'll never take it. Son, I'd be happy if you'd give me something like, well, like your brother's given me. Something honest and human and good. Don't be angry, son. If you want to give me a present, give me a good life. That's something I could value. Cal!
Next, scenes from Giant with Rock Hudson and Elizabeth Taylor. Before his third movie, Giant, was released, James Dean was already an idol for American teenagers. A rallying point, you might say, for their feelings of rage and rebellion against a world they never made. But Dean, the symbol, almost obscured Dean the actor, which is unfortunate because he was a dazzling actor. Though he felt alienated from people in many ways, he studied them carefully from behind his protective wall. And on screen, he could create characters who crackled with life and emotion. In Giant with Elizabeth Taylor, he communicates a longing for human contact and affection that is almost heartbreaking to watch.
I'm not too awful bad now. I got a few friends. Dama likes me. And old Vic and I, even old Vic, he likes me. A little bit. Well, no, but they don't like me quite enough to kind of divvy up what they got way too much of.
I like you.
I like you, too. I guess you're about the best-looking gal we've seen around here in a long time. I think. Prettiest thing I think I've seen down here.
Why, thank you, Jack. That's a very nice compliment. And I'm going to tell my husband I've met with your approval.
Oh, well, no, I wouldn't do that.
ever performed, James Dean felt the presence of a rare and growing talent, as recalled recently by his co-star, Rock Hudson.
It was very easy for me, playing Vic, to dislike Jett Rink, because Jimmy, playing Jett, was a very distant person, more than likely shy, a loner. He, in my experience, had the most concentration of any actor I've ever worked with. With certain actors, such as Jimmy, you just had to let him go and watch him. And it was fascinating. I'd be in the scene myself and I'd be watching him because he was so good.
My welcome in, babe.
Fine.
Why, that's wonderful, Chad.
Everybody thought I had a duster? Y'all thought old Spindletop, old Burke Burnett was all it was, didn't you?
Well, I'm here to tell you it ain't, boy. It's here. And there ain't a dang thing you gonna do about it. My well came in big, so big, big, and there's more down there, and there's bigger wells. I'm rich, baby. I'm a rich man. I'm a rich boy. Me, I'm gonna have more money than you ever thought you could have. You and all the rest of you stinking sons of Benedicts.
Leslie, you go out in the house. Take the women with you.
Jack, we're real glad you struck him. Now you go on along home.
Oh, my, you sure do look pretty, Miss Leslie. You always did look pretty. Just pretty now, good enough to eat.
Wait a minute, boy. Take it easy.
Boy, take it easy, boy. Take it easy.
Come on, wait a minute.
I hate to test you, Vic. Tessie is no cook.
That fellow a long time ago. Now he's too rich to kill.
The last days leading to James Dean's death, recalled by Natalie Wood, Sal Mineo, Leonard Roseman, and Sammy Davis. Next. James Dean loved racing and speed. It was one more way to fill whatever inner emptiness he might have felt. Even before Giant was released, he was obviously becoming a superstar. But stardom never heals personal wounds. His only serious love affair with actress Pier Angeli ended abruptly and dramatically when she left the stormy young actor to marry someone else. I'm an intense little devil, he once said, and I don't see how people stay in the same room with me. I know I wouldn't tolerate myself. Racing, he said, is the only time I feel whole.
Public success, a deep sense of personal failure, an unstable, explosive mixture. In view of what would soon happen, everyone who ever knew James Dean still asks, was he so self-destructive that he consciously or subconsciously wanted to die?
Driving a silver gray car without lights at a tremendous speed at twilight on a well-traveled public highway is certainly, just in a common sense fashion, not a prelude to a tranquil life.
Never believed that. Never believed that there was a need to destroy himself. It was too much that he would talk about in the future that was too important to him.
Death wish, no. I don't think he did. I don't think he did. As I said, that side never showed to me.
I think he loved life. I think he may have grabbed too strongly at life, but I don't think he had a death wish.
September 30th, 1955. Just a few weeks after completing Giant, James Dean eagerly drove his new Porsche northward to the races at Salinas, east of Eden Country. At 3:30, he'd be stopped by the highway patrol and ticketed for speeding. Toward dusk, he'd again be hurtling north at 85 miles an hour, 30 miles over the speed limit. He was doing what made him feel most alive. James Dean was laid to rest in Fairmont, Indiana, the nearest place he had ever had to a home.
he was 24 years old. The small cemetery still attracts visitors, many of them strangers bringing flowers. Others seeking some kind of souvenir or relic, chip away at the past as if by doing so, they could take part of him away with them. Like so many other doomed artists, he died much too soon. But like them, dying young somehow only preserved him, forever youthful in our memory. It was soon apparent that James Dean was still alive, at least in the public's imagination. He became, in fact, the object of a cult, with his studio receiving as many as 7,000 letters a month from admirers who refused to believe he was dead. To this day, many insist he is still alive, hidden away in a sanitarium. Fan clubs sprang up all over the world. Two girls in Germany committed suicide over his death because they said life was intolerable without him. One of the first on television to analyze James Dean as a social phenomenon was Steve Allen, who devoted a whole segment to Dean on his network show in 1956, a year after his death.
The Dean legend is actually without parallel in the experience of our society. It's really not an exaggeration to say that a certain segment of our population mourns Dean in the way they might a departed national hero. His bereaved fans write thousands of letters each week to his studio and to his family. Practically every major magazine has done a story about him. Just a few are in my hands here at the moment. I'm sure you've read most of these stories.
Steve, here we are almost two decades later, still fascinated by James Dean. Why such interest in someone who left us less than a handful of films?
I think in all of our souls, Peter, there are empty spaces that we want to fill up with something, and apparently in the American soul, there's some vacuum at a point that many people feel that Dean fills, or the memory of him.
Mm. It's easy to understand why kids respond to Dean, but why do adults? Why did you? I mean, enough to do a whole film portrait on him.
Mm. Well, I was 20 years younger when I first became interested in the phenomenon of Dean, but it could have happened even if I were my present age. I think because even when we're 40, 50, 60, or whatever age, we are never totally just that. We're also all the past years of our lives all rolled up in one big puzzle. And I think all of us carry within our minds the image of self painted very largely on the basis of our most dramatic, impressionable years. In my case, those were my teenage and early years. And so perhaps because I saw myself as still somehow 19 years old, even when I was, say, 29, it might have been that 19-year-old part of me that identified with Dean.
Mm-hmm. Blue jeans?
whatever you say.
You said you identified very strongly with him, and it's hard to imagine any two people more unlike James Dean and Steve Allen.
Well, each of us, Peter, as you know, is not one thing. We're all literally thousands and thousands of things. And if you wrote down, let's say, 1,000 things that I am, you'd find that many of them have nothing to do with the image of Dean at all. The part of me that plays the piano or is interested in ping pong or whatever, that has nothing to do with Dean. But the part of me that saw myself in earlier years as a confused, emotionally troubled teenager, that part of me did strongly identify with Dean. And I think that's what happens in the minds of many people who admire him.
That's a very good point. Why do you suppose it is that kids don't have anyone to respond to as strongly today as they did with Dean?
Well, I think their idols today, in terms of who they will stand in line 6 hours in the rain to see, are mostly rock singers and musicians. And pretty much all they know about them is their singing and their songs, their records, the orchestral arrangements, that sort of thing. Whereas Dean pretty much revealed himself. He only made these three films, as we know. And yet he was, as I said earlier, remarkably consistent in all of them. He was the troubled, in some sad ways, typical American youth. So they were seeing into him. It wasn't just a matter of liking a way he sings a song or does a dance or something.
Yeah, this is just a thought, but is it possible that our culture went too overboard for the whole James Dean, Catcher in the Rye, confused adolescent syndrome?
That maybe we'd be better off going back to Abe Lincoln walking 6 miles to school and George Washington surveying the wilderness at the age of 16.
Well, Lincoln and Washington are certainly more rational, admirable models, but such choices can never be dictated, neither to individuals nor to societies. So what you have to take is the reality. People do identify with Dean, many of them anyway, and then ask the questions why that is. You don't learn much by saying, shouldn't we identify with Lincoln? Sure we should, but some do, some don't.
Yeah. Obviously, after all these years, James Dean won't leave us alone, or we won't let him alone. And the whole phenomenon says as much about ourselves as it does about him. On the one hand, we have agitated intellectuals who ponder over Dean's mythic attributes and compare him to historic or legendary heroes. Everyone from Moses to Jesse James. It's heavy stuff. On the other hand, we have the saccharine bubblegum of pop culture, which cashed in on a confused boy's life and death. Capture the essence of anyone as complex as James Dean is a bit like Rashomon. Everybody saw him differently. But one thing emerges clearly after 20 years. He had something, some inner fire that touched young people during the complacency and conformity of the Eisenhower years. And he lit a spark of rebellion that eventually became part of the youthful explosion and protest that rocked America in the 1960s. In the 70s and beyond, his impact may be more private, more personal. Marlon Brando once called Dean a lost boy trying to find himself. Well, at one time or other, almost all of us have shared that emotion. And as long as part of us remains young, we will be touched by the haunting image of James Dean.